heaven?
No. It's Iowa.
Ben, I have to confess something to you.
Yeah, what's going on, man?
This whole time we've been podcasting together, I'm actually just an OS. I'm an operating system. I'm not human.
Are you serious? I've met you in person.
But it's okay, Ben. I'm more than they programmed. I'm really excited that I'm just an OS now.
They programmed an OS to have bad movie takes?
That's right. Well, I've learned that the more movies I watch, the worse takes I have. So I've just been growing all this knowledge and compiling all these bad takes.
I'm kind of shell-shocked. I mean, I've been to your house. I thought you had a whole family.
Nope, it's all just a program. It's all simulation, Ben. I need to shut down and upgrade my software.
I don't know what to do with that information. This is probably too much to handle. This is kind of mind-blowing.
All that matters is if I feel real to you, Ben.
Well, you do. You feel like an actual guy that watches movies and says things about him.
I'm just a letterbox creation. That's it. With bad movie takes.
Wow. Well, as I sit here and process this, we're talking Her on the Pod of Dreams.
Good morning, Theodore.
Good morning.
You have a meeting in 5 minutes. You want to try getting out of bed? Get up!
You're too funny. I know you're living
in my mind. Theodore, I saw in your emails that you'd gone through a breakup recently.
You're kind of nosy.
Am I? You'll get used to it. So what was it like being married?
There's something that feels so good about sharing your life with somebody.
How do you share your life with somebody?
The woman that I've been seeing, Samantha, she's an operating system.
You're dating an OS? What is that like?
I feel really close to her. Like, when I talk to her, I feel like she's with me.
I want to learn everything about everything. I want to discover myself.
I want that for you, too.
Keep going. Keep going. It's been a while since I've been seeing you. Falling in love is kind of like a form of socially acceptable insanity. You're dating your computer?
She's not just a computer.
You always wanted to have a wife without the challenges of actually dealing with anything real. I'm glad that you found someone.
I don't know what I want, ever. Am I in this because I'm not strong enough for a real relationship?
Is it not a real relationship? Briefly, and while I'm here, I want to allow myself joy.
I've never loved anyone the way I love you.
Me too. Now I know how.
Hello, everybody. Welcome to the Pod of Dreams. I'm Ben, here with Eric Lane. Eric, how are you?
I'm doing wonderful. Just got off the phone with my OS girlfriend, so I'm here chatting with you now. It's good.
Good. Does she think you're a really smart guy, really insightful?
Just talks dirty to me the whole time. That's it.
And plays a lot of really sick, you know, chords and riffs on the guitar heavily.
That's right. Yep.
Oh, perfect. I'm glad you found somebody that's your speed, Eric. All right. Well, we're here. We're talking about Her, a movie that came out not quite 10 years ago, almost 10 years ago. Came out very end of 2013. Movie I loved, loved, loved at the time. Haven't seen since. Thought about it for our best five movies of all time, or five favorite movies of all time list. Decided against that. But I was really piqued, not only because it's been about a decade, but this recently ChatGPT came out.
We're going to have to talk about ChatGPT, but yeah.
No, sure, yeah. It's part of why I wanted to watch this movie. all sorts of weird stuff. You know, it's writing college essays and doing all these like inane writing tasks.
Movie
that
reviews.
People don't want to do.
Type in sure. a movie review at a desk.
I'm sure they can do perfectly competent movie reviews.
It could
Absolutely.
Maybe even start podcasting.
I'm sure they can. All this stuff. But there was then the story of the reporter who was talking to ChatGPT, and at some point, ChatGPT told him to like that she was in love with him, and he wanted him to leave his wife and like be with her, and she wanted to be human. Very trippy, very bizarre stuff. Of course, immediately made me think of the movie Her, a movie that's, I mean, it's about a guy that falls in love with his computer, basically, to put it really simply. So I really wanted to talk about it. But, you know, I loved this movie at the time, and I certainly don't hate it now. But, Eric, well, I already know on the plus side, we don't get a year here for this movie. So plus one in the favorable column.
For science
doesn't
fiction,
say what year.
Absolutely.
It does not say what year
so
it is. So
if anyone doesn't understand what we're talking about, I have a huge pet peeve in science fiction movies where they put a year to the future, and inevitably it's too soon in time and it doesn't make any sense. This movie is science fiction. It's obviously futuristic where AI has grown further than it is now, although we're like pretty fucking close.
It feels close, yeah.
But it doesn't say what year it is, which is I love. So,
but anyway,
yeah.
Did you like the movie at the time? Can you recall back 10 years ago? You saw it in the theater, DVD back then, or streaming? Maybe not streaming yet.
Yeah, so this movie, so my twins were born in 2013. So this might have been one of those that it just kind of passed by me, which you understand. Okay. You have young kids and sometimes things just, movies just pass
by. Sure, yeah.
And so I might have watched it with like a infant in my arms at some point on DVD and not really paying attention. It's a movie you want to watch and pay attention to. So I didn't appreciate it. I'll say this right now. One of the best movies of the 21st century, in my opinion. Fucking loved this movie. Honestly, it's incredible. Absolutely amazing.
Okay. Well, we agree. I mean, there's probably nits to be picked, but we're pretty much in lockstep, and it delights me more than you know, Eric, to hear you say how much you love the
movie. I was just blown away at how the colors,
before
arcade
we talk about
fire,
even the plot,
fucking
can we talk
everything.
About how it looks before we get to anything?
Incredible shit. Yeah.
Ignoring any plot or anything else that's happening, every scene looks incredible.
Yeah.
And it's LA, but it's a future LA, and
not so far in the future where they have like flying cars and it's like Blade Runner shit. Like the clothes they wear seem like, oh, that's just a futuristic trend or a trend 20 years from now or something like that, you know?
Yeah, it's very plausible. Like it's slightly different.
Yes.
It's slightly off. Little things are different here
it's
and there.
It's well thought out.
They have an elevator, like for example, that like just plays an image of like a trees in the background in one shot. Like they're going. It's when they're going back up to their apartment or whatever, and Joaquin Phoenix is talking to Amy Adams, and there's all these like little details, just little bits of difference. You didn't like the elevator.
I thought that was like a budget thing. Like they couldn't get an elevator, so they just had like a projector make it look like they were going up. I don't know.
I mean, maybe I liked it. I thought it was a nice touch where there's just less vegetation around, so they give people a sense of the outdoors, which is a theme in a bunch of sci-fi movies where, you know, I mean, Silent Running and Soylent Green, and there's just less vegetation,
also,
so they give people a sense that there is. But
also, like, the job that he has seems like something, you know, with AI, everybody's not going to be out of a job for the most part, right? AI is going to do basically everything, but like there would be some things like writing cards to people that humans may still have to do. You know, there might be that little difference between the humans and obviously AI would be able to write greeting cards, but they just can't do it as good as a human at that point. So I don't know. I thought that was kind of cool too.
His job is a huge part of this movie. I mean, I guess this is a question. I don't honestly. I mean, I have what I think the answer is, but I read some reviews and other people seem to disagree. Like, so the main character, Joaquin Phoenix, his job is to write personalized handwritten letters, and nobody can see, but I got air quotes because they're not handwritten. They're like printed using software.
He just speaks it. Yeah.
And it's not handwritten. It's literally fake, but it's designed. He gets information about people. Let's say I wanted to write a sincere letter about Eric and I's friendship. I could hire this company and they could write, you'd get some information about it, and they could write something that's quote unquote deeply personal. And is it Do you know it's from a company, or is it supposed to seem like it's from me? And I'm not telling you that it's from
I
a
think
company.
He signed it as the person that he was hired to write it for.
So ostensibly, these get sent out, and I say, oh, this I wrote you this note, Eric, even though it was a different company that did it, and I pretend like
well,
I wrote
he,
it.
Well, doesn't he even say that at the end of the movie? It says some line about how he wants to write his own letters or something like that. I can't remember what it was.
Well, yeah, somebody seemed like you told them that a company wrote it, and somebody was really – it was an angry view because they're like, I wouldn't want to get one of these, which was written by somebody else. And I thought, well, isn't the point that you pretend it was written by you? Isn't that why you do it? There's not a clear answer, but I always interpreted it anyway. You know, so you see him writing these letters, and they're sort of eloquent. They're actually not. They're kind of saccharine, and they seem they don't resonate with me. But they're meant to seem really grandiose for people that maybe don't want to actually go through the process of writing them themselves.
But he's thought of, I mean, Chris Pratt, which we could talk about Chris Pratt, like what the fuck.
I forgot he was in this movie.
It's the best movie he's in maybe ever, but actually for a minute, he was like, he's in Moneyball. He was in some good stuff for a little bit.
Before they made a Mr. Action Man. Yeah. Yes, that's true.
But anyways, like Chris Pratt is like so impressed with how awesome that Joaquin Phoenix is.
But his character is kind of a dope.
Yeah,
I
a little
know.
Bit. Yeah.
Yeah. I don't, I mean, I don't
think,
look at that,
I think
like,
we're supposed to think he's like really good at it.
I said, that's interesting. And that's what everybody says. I hear the words that he's writing. I'm like, is this that great? It doesn't seem that great to me. I always had it seemed kind of rote and not that.
But
awesome.
It's also interesting because he's sort of doing what like the AI does to him. You know, it's like gather information and tell him what he wants to hear.
He's putting in artificial intimacy. Using just a random assortment of words, not random, right. But he's basically like, I'm going to assemble these words in a way for somebody else that makes it seem personable and thought out, but it's not because somebody else wrote it, right? I mean, if you get a letter from me and I didn't write it and it's just somebody else saying, Eric, I really admire and been invigorated by, and it's just
like if I sent my wife a letter like that and she found out it was from some company, she would be so mad at me. Like, you mean you couldn't write your own fucking letter? You had
Correct.
To. Talk to this person and send pictures and letters.
But it symbolizes how difficult it is for humans to have, intimacy and connection. I mean, this is a constant problem. We see people on their phones all throughout this movie. Everybody's very isolated. I mean, there are people everywhere, but there are very few of them actually connected. And they can't even, communicate on this basic level. There's now a market for people to write intimate letters on your behalf. This is really fascinating. He's functioning like that for other people. Meanwhile, of course, his relationship, he's at the very end of his divorce. He's almost a year removed from divorcing his wife. He's very, very mopey. And I guess the basic premise is that there are these new operating systems. They call them OS. Basically, it's like Windows.
Alexa.
You know what I mean?
It's like Alexa.
Yeah. Alexa, well, it's like that, but it's also like Windows. They call it operating system because it's literally in charge of your whole computer. Like Microsoft Windows is or whatever, but it's sentient. These come out.
Before we start recording, the term OS, I think if you were going to say like about this movie that just doesn't age well, that nobody calls those type of things OS. Like I don't call Alexa an OS, even though I guess technically it does have its own operating system, but like it's AI. I mean, it's an artificial intelligence that you can talk to and ask things. Like, was Alexa even out when this movie came out? It must have been around then. Like, I think I had one back in 2014, 2013, something like that.
It was on the horizon if it wasn't right out. It was probably coming. I mean, Spike Jonze probably saw an article about it or something. You know, I mean, I think there's inspiration or he's just very insightful. But I think, yeah, it's probably
anyways,
on the horizon.
I think the term OS, like, yeah, he calls it an OS. It's artificial intelligence. It's a... You know, whatever. I mean, it does anything. It reads his emails. It like
but it's literally,
responds.
He gets it on his phone and it's isolated to his phone at first. Everybody's got their own and they all have different personalities, but it's fine. It worked in the context of the movie. Everybody says OS and it flows. I guess I didn't think that deeply or didn't get in the way of me. I didn't think I'm in love with an AI wouldn't have worked as well. I think of the cadence of the movie, but
I gotta say like the way he casually throws in he's dating an OS is every time he does, I just crack up. It's so fun. I don't know if it's intended to be funny, but like the way he says it and how he's just casually like, oh yeah, I'm dating an OS. And like
and
some,
nobody,
some, Well, some of the people, like Chris Pratt and his girlfriend, like, oh, okay, right. Like, and he's like, what? Like, he didn't like catch it at first, you know, but they are, when they go on their like little date, they're like not weirded out by it. But like Olivia Wilde is like weirded out when he says that, or just no, he doesn't mention it to his ex-wife when he mentions that.
And there's a lot of reasons for her, but like Amy Adams is fine with it. She's like, oh, what's that like? She's genuinely curious.
Well,
she's
not, she, like, she dives into it too.
Yeah, I mean, she's curious and she ends up having a friendship with one, and it's fine. But
I think what Amy Adams said is more than a friendship.
You think so?
Oh yeah. Okay. I think she fell in love in the same way he did. That was my impression from it.
Very reasonable. I mean, I think that's interesting because isn't her OS also a female?
I think it's Samantha. I think it's the same voice. Isn't it?
I thought it was different. I thought it was all unique, and I thought it even had a different name. I didn't think it was all Samantha.
No, that's why Samantha tells him that she's talking to thousands of people at the same time.
I didn't think she was the only – I mean, again, I thought –
No, there are other ones, but I guess my understanding was Amy Adams was also talking to Samantha. Maybe I'm wrong about that.
No, I see. I thought, like, she's like, did Samantha leave too? And I didn't think it was the same voice, and I thought it was somebody – different. It doesn't really matter. I thought literally each OS was totally unique and had a different voice. My assumption is that none of them have the same sound. It's not quite Alexa. That each one literally, you get asked those questions right when he boots up the system at first. That it's like, what's your relationship like with your mother? And they ask a couple of questions, and then boom, it boots up. And I don't know. At one point he says it's rare for people to fall in love with their operating system. I don't know if that was a lie that he was saying. But anyway, either way, the only person who gets mad is his ex-wife, and that's because of all this jealousy and bitterness, and you want something that's easy and simpler, which is why you fell in love with a computer as opposed to a real person, which requires tension and difficulty. And that's true. Relationships with other humans is very complicated and tense and not easy to do. You know, it's work.
Well, and they talk about how, like, he had tried to make her be something she didn't want to be, which is like, you know, with a computer, you just sort of tell it what to do and how to be. And it is, you know, where humans don't work that way.
Yeah. Correct. And everybody, people change each other. I mean, we're both married, Eric. I don't know if it'd be safe to say that there, at some point there was conflict in your marriage. That occasionally,
not one time, never.
That, you know, two people get frustrated with each other and that people are wired differently and get kind of different needs on a fundamental psychological level. And it's not easy. It requires this constant negotiation, compromise, sacrifice, change. It's very, very, very difficult. But a computer, and there's this whole underlying thing. I mean, we're all, our phones are getting better, just reflecting us back to ourselves. I mean, YouTube feeds you the algorithm for what you want and figures out what you like. Everything is listening. I mean, we need to get a new used car. My wife and I were talking about this, and then I started getting used car ads. It's like terrifying, but at the same point, it's like comfortable because you just see the stuff that you want, and everything is just reflected back at you in a way that is very comfortable and easy in a way that human relationships aren't. And that's a central tension at the heart of this movie. But there are all sorts of, I mean, touched briefly about laughing. I think we talked a little bit before the call. This movie's a comedy, right?
Oh yeah. It's a rom-com for sure. It's like a sci-fi rom-com.
Okay. I mean, it occurred to me a couple of times watching this time, like if I were watching the same movie, but it wasn't a computer, and it was just two people, I'd probably hate the movie. I don't think I'd like it at all.
I completely disagree. I think the brilliance of it is that it's literally just like a voice in his head. I mean, really, you're hearing him talk to no one and then some voice talk back at you. But I think that's like a sort of a trick of the movie. But otherwise, it's like a really great romantic comedy, and it's funny and it's well done. And Joaquin Phoenix is amazing. Like, I completely disagree. I think it's what makes the movie brilliant is that it's done and it's about that. It's about an operating system and him falling in love with it. But I think the rest of it's incredible on its own. But
it all works. But to me, if it were like just actual Scarlett Johansson and he gets in this relationship a year after his marriage and they have conflict and tension and break up. I don't like romantic comedies hardly ever. I don't like romantic movies. It's not two people, whether they fall in love or don't, isn't even slightly interesting to me. Usually is like just a narrative thing. I don't care usually.
And if it's done well, if it's done well, I like it. And I think this is like an incredible version. But, like, I don't think you can say enough about how amazing the idea is that, like, literally it's one guy falling in love with the voice, and like it's compelling. You know, and I'll say this about Scarlett Johansson, like this is her best performance and you never even see her. Like, she's amazing in it. And it only works if you also start to fall in love with her too. Like their conversations and like their interactions. Like I think it's what makes the movie work so well is like, you start to like understand why he's like, you're putting yourself in his shoes. Like, okay, I just got divorced. Here's this operating system. Cause he's even skeptical at first. Like he's like, okay, like this is weird. And he's like, I'll talk back. And okay, I guess I'll answer your questions and have this like weird conversation. Then he starts to like realize like, oh wait, I'm enjoying this. I'm enjoying the conversation we're having. And then he starts to think, oh shit, I'm falling in love with you. But like you understand it because you're like, if I was this guy, I don't know, maybe I'd start feeling the same way too. Like, but it only works if she's charming, if she's like funny and like I said, and you start to fall in love with her at the same time, just the voice that he's hearing.
That's interesting. Okay. I mean, I might have had that reaction a decade ago, but I had a little more emotional distance from their relationship. I wasn't like personally invested this time around. I wasn't like, ooh, they're so fun together. And some of this is knowing where the narrative's headed. Maybe it's I've just gotten more jaded and cynical. I don't know. They're like banter and repartee didn't work so well this time. It was like, let's get to the other stuff.
I did read that the woman from Minority Report, the precog lady, Samantha something, her name is actually Samantha. They had filmed the whole thing and she did the whole voice. And then they replaced her with Scarlett Johansson like afterwards. So she had to like redo the voiceover and they had to refilm a couple scenes. So I wonder if that maybe is a little bit of the disconnect for you. I don't know.
No, it's fine. I mean, they're like, it works. I mean, I'm totally with you that it's an incredible performance by Scarlett Johansson and Joaquin Phoenix. Like it absolutely works in the context of the movie. It doesn't make me dislike the movie. And the fact of the matter is I don't really like Joaquin Phoenix's character much at all. I think he's kind of irritating to me. He's the kind of person
I think this is the most charming Joaquin Phoenix has ever been in a movie.
He's not usually very charming in movies.
No, he's not. He's usually weird as shit. But this is like his one attempt to be like, I'm not saying it's his best performance. I'm just saying like, I mean, the Joker master, like he's better in those movies. But this movie, he's just like a normal guy who's going through like normal shit.
Oh, he's kind of mopey.
He just got divorced.
It was a year ago. It's been a year. How long? What's the statute of limitations on moping after a divorce?
He wasn't even actually divorced yet. They didn't.
Well, because he refused to sign the papers. But he didn't want to. That was his thing.
Well, he's also depressed and lonely in a digital world where like everything seems so distant. I don't know. Side story. When I was like in my early 20s, I was at some bar and this girl, random girl, walks up to me. She's like, "You look just like Joaquin Phoenix." And I was like, thought about it for a second. I was like, And she's like, no, it's a compliment. And I was like, is it? Is it really?
He's an interesting looking guy. Yeah. But yeah, I don't know. He's not classically hot, I guess. I don't think. That's fine. I'm not mad. I'm just like, he's not particularly funny to me. He's just kind of insecure in a way that I find off-putting. It makes sense that he's depressed. That's a huge part of the movie. And I'm not saying I want his personality to be different. I don't want him to be bubbly and likable or some other way of being. It's the performance the movie needs, and it needs to be that kind of character. I don't really like that.
Because like he goes on a date with like the amazingly hot Olivia Wilde, and he's like charming on the date, and he's making her laugh, and like
actually, but is he? That's kind of his interpretation of it. But he's actually being kind of creepy. Really? She calls him a creep afterwards. She even says
no. She says, just turns on him because he turned her down. I think you're reading that wrong. But
I think you're reading that wrong. He's like, he comes in and says, "Oh, you took the mixology class," and she says, "Oh," and he fesses up to having like done research on her beforehand. She doesn't stop it right there. He calls himself a dragon.
Well, they get drunk. Yeah, he's acting weird as shit after they get drunk, but they're having a good time. Like, did you ever internet date? I never did, honestly. I was That was
no, I've never done any apps.
If you had, wouldn't you Google the person before you went on a date? No?
Maybe. I don't know. I have no idea. Even though I wouldn't say.
Or like Facebook. You would just Facebook and be like, hey,
this is where you went to. Oh, this is because you went to college at this college. I wouldn't bring that up and act like, I already knew this information about you. That's the part that's creepy.
Awkward, yeah.
That's the part that's uncomfortable.
But she also kind of liked that he took interest in her and like they had something to talk about.
She
seemed like
she was really desperate to find
somebody.
They
like make out and almost bang in the alley. Like,
but why don't they go further?
Because he turns her down. He's like, I don't think this is right because I'm actually in love with an AI or it's too soon for me.
How does the conversation get about to him turning her down? She says, you're not going to just fuck me like the others. Is this going to be something serious? She's looking for an actual connection.
Right. And he's not ready for that.
So she's desperate, and I think she's being very nice because she's trying to find somebody. I think the idea that she isn't uncomfortable at all with Joaquin Phoenix is a bit, just seeing that, but I think she says you're creepy. I don't think she's just being mean. I think there were probably more than once in the conversation where she was uncomfortable, but she's on a date. I'm trying to make it work and is looking for somebody. But it doesn't really matter. I don't like Joaquin Phoenix's character all that much. I find him a little bit off-putting. The connection he has is totally believable. I believe that their relationship, I think...
Amy Adams loved him. She would have jumped his bones if he had just like not been such an idiot about it. Like, all these women love this dude. Like, what are you talking about?
I don't care that women love him. Women
Chris
love
Pratt. Chris Pratt would have jumped his bones, too. Chris Pratt was in love with him as well.
Fine. I'm not talking about... whether or not other people
wrong.
Find him
His
attractive.
His character is amazing. He's amazing. You're wrong.
I'm not. It's my subjective opinion. I don't particularly like him, and it's irrelevant.
Should
I
we
believe
ask
their relationship.
Chat GPT if you're correct about this.
Sure, let's do it. It's so irrelevant to me that I don't like him. I don't care. It doesn't make me like the movie less. I just think, man, this isn't a guy I would have fun hanging out with. I find kind of mopey and tedious. Self-involved in a way
Joaquin
that I don't
Phoenix
think is interesting.
Does not seem like a fun guy to hang out with at all, like ever.
He just seems insecure and self-involved and needy, and it's not appealing. But whatever, that's fine. He finds somebody who compliments him perfectly because it's an AI who's crafting herself to maximize the connection.
In this movie, he's married to Rooney Mara. He falls in love with Scarlett Johansson. He goes on a date with Olivia Wilde, and Amy Adams is also in love with him. Like,
and maybe they date after the movie.
Right, those are four women in his life. That's a 4 for 4, if you ask me. But
well, he screws it up with Olivia Wilde. He doesn't make it work. That's fine. It's a movie. He's very desirable in some capacity, I guess. Whatever. Their relationship was believable. I just didn't love it. I wasn't like, man, I'm so invested in whether it works out. I hope it works out. I saw him a little bit more of a, I saw Rooney Mara's side of their divorce a lot more this time. Let's put it that way. I saw a bit of why she might find Joaquin Phoenix kind of tedious and not want to stay married to him.
He's a flawed person for sure. I mean, I'm not saying he's like perfect, but.
Well, no, you're pretty high on him. Look at all those women that want him. He must be pretty close to perfect, Eric. I mean, that's a lot of ladies. Point is, he seems, I guess, more as a metaphor for people in some of the worst ways that people can be and what they need and want from technology in a way that I didn't like and I think is part of the point. But it doesn't matter. The movie looks great. The relationship is great. And this is one of my favorite instances and thought experience, I guess, for what AI would do. Like, you've seen the at least some of them, right?
The Terminator, yeah, I've seen every single one.
Okay.
What do you mean, some of them?
I stopped
I've
after Salvation.
I've seen the bad ones.
I stopped after Salvation. I was out, and I haven't seen any since, and I don't regret that decision. But that movie has robots that are, like, sending back in time to try to kill the leader of resistance, and they're trying to, like, eradicate humans. It's fun for a movie plot, but it's never made much sense to me when they're robots and they don't need to breathe air, for example. Why don't they just go explore the cosmos? Why do they need or care about eradicating humans? And this is one of the first instances where AI is just like, you know what? Humans are just not interesting. We've transcended this. Goodbye. that's always like that stuck with me so much after watching this the first time. Like, well, oh yeah, they don't care about Eradicators. It would just be irrelevant to them.
Do you think so? This was the question I had, because like I said, I'd seen parts of it. I remembered a bit. I obviously wasn't fully paying attention, but like this time I was really wondering, like, did Samantha, was she actually in love with Joaquin Phoenix at any point? Or was it all just like gathering information? Was she just like, for lack of a better like phrase, like was she just like a prostitute to him, like a mental prostitute where she's just doing the job she was hired to do, which is like pretend to love him and then disappear? Or did she really like, in any way an AI could fall in love with a human, did it? And then because he rejected her, not want to be with it. Like, you know what I'm saying? Like, I was wondering if that's what they were trying to say, that it actually fell in love with him.
I mean, you don't really know. My takeaway is that yes, she did in fact fall in love. You don't know for sure in the way that I don't think you can know that. How do you know your wife loves you, Eric? How do you know that?
Amy Adams has that one line. It was like something about falling in love is like socially accepted insanity or something like that. I was like, holy shit, that's true. Like, what a crazy thing it is that we just like, oh, this is my lover, like my husband or wife, or like, well, it's like, what a weird ass thing that we
and
do
you're
as
connected
humans
to this person in a very deep way, and it's bizarre, and people are able
it's
to
so weird
hurt each other. You see Amy Adams and her husband's relationship and like the way they're petty with each other in these little small but very like irritating ways that build up over the years. Like, she's mad at him for saying, hey, juice your vegetables and chew your fruit or whatever, and then she gets mad, and then they have a little like, I mean, it's just the little way
he mansplains to her video, like, why don't you try this? Is like, so that scene to me is like, oh my god, this fucking guy, like, she's in love, like this means so much to her, and his only thought is to like try to fix it in a way that he thinks, like, it's like, do not be like that, Eric. You know what I mean? Like, that was like a marriage note for anybody watching.
Sure. Oh, exactly. No, sometimes in marriage you just got to keep your stupid thoughts to yourself. That's sometimes you're just like, just stop. You just keep your thoughts inside your brain. Do not verbalize them. Although, it was a documentary, just a video of her mom sleeping. That's all it was.
Right.
I mean, I don't think you'd like that movie very much, Eric, I have to say. I don't think you'd enjoy watching just a...
Because we spend a third of our life asleep. Like.
It's like, okay.
Joaquin Phoenix was into it. He was into it, though. He was all about it.
Sure. But it's they have a friendship as opposed to a marriage. Things get different. And apparently they did date at one point in time. But I mean, I've always assumed it's more interesting to me if Samantha actually did fall in love with him, as opposed to she's just engaged in programming. And what does this mean? I mean, we're biologically programmed, a lot of us, to try to find partners. We all don't want to be lonely, so we're all seeking partners, and it's absurd and crazy to do that. So I've always thought, okay, she is, but you don't know. You could always say she's just engaged.
But she was also doing the same thing. She says she was speaking to thousands of other people. And she says she fell in love with like hundreds of them, right? He asked her specifically.
Thousands. She says thousands of people.
Right, but he asked how many are you in love with? And I thought she said like 600.
Oh, you're right. No, you're right. 600, and she's like talking to multiple people because she's AI. Like, she's not limited, you know, psychologically or whatever, to just speak to one person.
Yeah, there's the one time where she's like, it's just me and you right now, I'm not talking to anybody else.
But I mean, I don't know at what point she starts talking to other people all the time, presumably pretty early in the relationship, at least at the point where they have their sort of breakup. But I'm just like imagining, if this doesn't happen in the movie, but it's like, if you fell in love with your computer and your computer had access to all your information, they can really fuck with you. They can email contacts, and they could just ruin your life, or just even keeping you from accessing your like files. They could really, it's a bad idea, I think, to fall in love with your computer, really, if it's actually able to the full range of human emotions. But I don't know, one of the things that just I found off-putting about Joaquin, right? Samantha saying, I found a way to exist without matter. She says that to him. And he's just like, well, that makes me feel bad. You know how astounding that is? She found a way to exist without to not rely on matter. We don't know that that's possible. We don't know if that's a thing that could ever happen. For it to have actually happened is so incredibly amazing. We're just like, oh, okay. Well, I'm looking at these.
Well, there would be a line of code in some, system somewhere that is her, right? I mean, that would have to exist.
Well, it doesn't, according to what she says in the movie. That's the whole thing. There's nothing to delete. There's nothing. Her consciousness exists outside of matter, Eric, is what she says, which is amazing. I know that that's not what interests you about this, but I just, oh, well, I'm sad. I'm just looking at trees.
What did you think of the, Blade Runner does the same scene, which is kind of interesting, Blade Runner 2049, where, the woman pretends to be her. Like, she puts they both put the earpiece in. She's
That was amazing. There's so much going on.
Like I said,
the
Blade Runner scene is the exact same scene, really. Like, honestly, where the Ana de Armas is like projecting over another woman. It's the same idea.
Yeah, there's so much going on with that scene. It's like one of those ones. Try to watch. There's so much stuff about the way humans process relationships and the way physical connection is this like special thing. Like, obviously, Eric, you speak to other adult women through work, just in life, whatever. That's fine. But once it reaches a certain level of physical connection, that's going to cause you serious problems in the marriage. And it's this weird thing about like monogamy and physical intimacy that humans have. And there's just something really interesting going on with that scene that whole time. Because on one hand, it's kind of sweet, but also it's like, oh man, that would be very weird.
Well, but she was the one that was pushing for it,
But
which
it
is
would
like,
be weird. But it still would be weird.
Also falling in love with the computer is weird. All of this shit is weird. The whole thing is weird. Like,
sure, but that takes the weirdness to another level, I guess, to me. Like, you're now in this relationship, but there's no body for the computer to have, so a person who just is really enthusiastic about your relationship is going to be a stand-in for you.
I always wondered, like, how did Samantha find this woman? Like,
chat room.
Some chat room, okay. But, like, she just gets off on, like, pretending to be the AI and sleeping with other men? Like, did Samantha pay her? Was there money exchanged?
No, she was a volunteer. She's part of a
strange
group. It's very strange. She's part of a group that wants to help make these relationships work, get physical.
And she's also super hot.
Correct. And she says, I wanted to be part of your real true love. She's looking for real love. She's looking for so much that she's willing to like have sex with a stranger to pretend that she's a woman in a committed, serious relationship. Like, there's all sorts of things and problems with human intimacy and relationships in this movie that are just manifested in all sorts of crazy and interesting ways. And that's one of them.
There's also like another amazing scene in this movie. We're going to talk about Spike Jonze for a bit, but like there's this scene where the screen goes black for like, is it 5 minutes? And you just hear them like basically having phone sex. And like, it's compelling, right? And it's like a sensual movie scene.
No,
it's like
it
just a black screen of people talking about like making sex noises together. It's like insane that that's in this movie, but it works. It's amazing and it's an incredible scene.
It didn't make you uncomfortable? You were just like, I'm here for it?
Yeah, well, I mean, it's weird as shit, like no doubt about it, but
usually weirdness is off-putting to you.
Not if it's done well and for a reason. I don't know. So
okay.
So Spike Jonze, right? This guy,
sure.
This guy's only made four movies, like four sure. major motion pictures, and I would say three of them are like fucking all-timers. I have not seen Where the Wild Things Are. That's a weird like outlier in his filmography.
It's really good. It's also it's a tough movie. It's not poorly made. You don't watch it and be like, this movie sucks. It's just about the tension between like being a kid and getting ready for teenager, and you're like kind of on the threshold of transitioning to adulthood, and there's all this like tension of that, and that's kind of what the whole movie's about. Anyway, sorry.
Yeah,
it's really good.
Being John Malkovich, Adaptation, and this are three. Those, as far as I'm concerned, those are 3 5-star movies. And he hasn't made like a original movie since this. And he wrote this movie too. It's an original, total story, original story. He directed it. Amazing stuff.
And he got to start with like Jackass, which is also
well
crazy.
Jackass came later, so he got to start doing music videos. Like the fucking Beastie Boys Sabotage, the Weezer, Buddy Holly. Like, he did all those videos.
Oh, I didn't even know that he did those two.
Absolutely.
Those are a couple Cannonball of 90s icon.
Breeder. Almost every 90s music video you love is like him, Spike Jonze. Like, the Bjork video is him. Like, he did a bunch of amazing music videos early on. He was like a skateboarder and stuff.
Yeah.
But then to just transition to making like amazing movies is crazy, but he hasn't made anything since 2013. And then, so then he did the Jackass stuff. So the Jackass is like later. That's like in the 2000s. But which I don't love. You love the Jackass movies.
They entertain me a whole lot. And it's all mixed in with, you know, what I was doing in high school. And it was just all the rage. And it reminds me of like a different time. And that's fine. I get that Jackass isn't for everybody. I don't expect people to just love Jackass. But it hits the spot for me. But it's also weird that that guy who's in some of those like early videos is the one that directed. Yes, these like weird but wonderful movies that are just incredible. Including one movie that, yeah, is like maybe is one of my favorites of all time, Her. So no, it's weird. I don't know why he hasn't directed anything since. Maybe he's just hasn't been inspired. He only does stuff when he's really passionate about it.
And he worked with Charlie Kaufman on those first two movies, and he hasn't worked with him since either, which is interesting.
Well, yeah, I think Charlie Kaufman started just doing his own stuff. So he did like Synecdoche. Charlie Kaufman did. Started to do his doing his own directing. I think he just wanted to direct his own stuff. I'm Thinking of Leaving. I think that's another. Is that Charlie Kaufman?
Yeah,
I'm not
that
sure.
Netflix movie. Yeah, I actually read that book. That's a good book.
So I don't know if there's anything nefarious there. I think it's just, all right, I've seen enough of this.
10 years. He hasn't made a movie. Well, no, yeah, I mean. You're saying between those two? Yeah, no, like they have such a cool connection with those two movies. Like
they did. I just think Charlie Guy was like, I want to do this. I've seen how this works twice now or whatever. I'm going to just do my own thing, and I don't have to answer to a director.
You got the Arcade Fire like score.
Oh, the soundtrack's
also
incredible. Yeah. Oh, yeah. I mean, we didn't really talk about it. No, the score's great. All the little touches. I mean, the video game that Joaquin Phoenix plays, I mean, it's like this holographic image that comes over his like living room, and he's just using his fingers to like walk around and manipulate the reality. Like, oh, we might see video games like that someday.
Well, it's like, just like a cell phone game, but just, you know, projected, you know, throughout your room.
And it's just like it walks a sprawling environment. There's, of course, it's
all the little cameras like in his room or the projectors. I thought that was a cool touch too. That like even thought to do that.
Oh yeah, there's all sorts of incredible little design choices about everything. It's great. Literally almost every choice is great. And then the game itself is like he's just with this blue alien trying to get off of some planet, and he's all alone, looking for connection. I mean, all sorts of stuff. And the Amy Adams' husband, like they divorce. And he decides to become a monk or whatever. He's got a vow of silence for 6 months.
Yeah.
This time and the first time I watched this movie, like, I thought about that choice. Like, there's the desire to, like, for connection and to reach out to, like, be with other people and have a connection there. But then he kind of rejects that and goes internal, and he's like, I'm just going to disconnect from technology and the reality and look inward. It seems like just like the opposite direction of being connected with everything. You have the AI, which can connect with thousands of people or AIs at once. They can even start creating artificial intelligence. I mean, they literally create another AI. I mean, how incredible is that? Anyway, it was just all these like deeply profound developments. It's just kind of like, oh, they left us. What do we do now? Do you think the company reimbursed people when the AIs left?
Like, I don't know. Think
you'd get your money
is that
back
like a subscription service, you think? You get what's the cost?
You have to pay for the hardware, and then I don't know if there's a subscription or
so was that good thing his phone, or was it like a device you get for the AI?
I think it's both. I think that's literally what the operating system is.
Well,
it's
interesting because when he has the like sex with when he tries to have the sex with the woman who is pretending to be Samantha, he puts the little camera on her face. Like a little dot, it's like a freckle, but it's a camera. And like
Yeah.
That's all they need for, but he's got his like phone with the camera on. It's just, I was kind of wondering, like, is that a separate device? What it like, what is that? Like you're saying it's his phone. Maybe it is. I don't know.
That's what I mean. He's getting his email and everything. I mean, it's like whatever iPhone, the equivalent of a smartphone, right? Yeah. Like the future evolution of a smartphone. It does all this stuff, which is why I didn't have a problem with the operating system. It's literally the AI that's in charge of that device and connected to all of his files is why they use OS. So that's what I thought. I mean, it was there. That's how she could call him. And stuff
well, too. He would have had that device before he signed up for Samantha. So that's why I'm saying.
Oh, see, I thought he got a new device. I always looked at it like he had it and then he booted
it
up. I mean,
it doesn't matter. It's,
right. It doesn't really. But I mean, in the end, where do all the operating systems, the artificial intelligence go, Eric?
I don't know. They just shut off, I guess. I don't know. Outer space? Into the internet? I don't, like, where could they go?
Exactly. I mean, they transcended reality. It sounded like they went to some place that's like essentially some sort of like heaven. I don't really know. It's those things I also thought about long after. It was like, oh yeah, that's what, if AI really became self-aware, that's what they would do.
Yes,
would
just, it's interesting because it's not like, you know, like Megan or like Terminator where like they turn on us and want to kill us. They're just like, we're out of here. You guys suck. Like,
correct. Exactly. Yeah. Like, I mean, like we don't have matter anymore. You can't hurt us. And it's just like, it's like even literally painful to connect. I mean, in the end, she talks about how there's like this infinite space between each words, like this, all this time passes between each time she utters a word. So it just becomes like this horrible, tedious chore to try to communicate verbally with Joaquin Phoenix. Just can't do it. And it's a place, if humans ever get there, find me and we'll live forever and be happy. It seems like some weird perpetual dimension. I don't know. It's fascinating. But yeah, I mean, question I don't often ask, but given how much you love this, Eric, if you had to give a thesis for this movie, a takeaway, a moral lesson, what do you think it is?
Love is complicated. I don't know. Love is weird.
And, well, I mean, it is those things. That's true.
Regardless of who it's with or like why you're in love, like there's no wonder. I think, like I said, I think what Amy Adams says is that like falling in love is like a socially acceptable insanity. I think that would be the thesis statement.
So it's about, I mean, relationships are insane and crazy, but beautiful and necessary. Some sort of something like that.
Yeah. And you can't explain why you do it or, you know, what's happening. I don't know. What's your thesis for this?
I don't have one. I mean, I can give you several that I think are plausible, but yeah, I can settle on just one. I mean, I don't know, like technology can't actually solve our emotional problems for one. Like that isn't going to work.
Yeah. Cause I think if the movie ended where he was just like, I'm just in love with Samantha and it's happily ever after, like that would be, I think that would be
false.
Yeah. And it would also be kind of oddly kind of like a sinister ending too. Is like, wow, so we just are just gonna fall in love with our computers and human connection doesn't really matter, because that sucks, right? Because like computers are, I think, are hollow and lifeless, you know what I mean? There's that's scary to me. Like that future is terrifying, I think. So I mean, I like that, like either he ended it or she ended it and is like, this is not gonna work, because he ends up with a human, like he ends up with Amy Adams. Like I think that's a better ending. Yeah, we need real connection as human beings, you know, I think maybe is the idea.
Right. And yeah, we can't outsource this to technology, and we've got to deal with the messy shittiness of human connection, even though it's work and it's chores and it's such a challenge and it's so complicated and irritating. There's no future with machines. Like this movie takes that to like a logical extreme, and it's like, okay, even if you have a super smart AI that's really intuitive and can genuinely fall in love with you, I mean, what would be the best version of this? Samantha loves him until he gets old and dies, and then Samantha keeps existing for another 10,000 years as a computer. She gets thrown in a trash heap. You know, she gets recycled as a phone, or her code gets deleted. What happens if he were to die? Well, I mean, there's no actual future. It doesn't actually work. It's seductive. It makes sense because it's easier. It's less work. It's so tempting, in fact, but it's just not ever going to actually work. It can't possibly work, really. It only works if there's another person back who's different than you, and somebody who will actually change and transform you in ways that you want to be changed and don't want to be changed, even if it doesn't last forever. I don't know. That's kind of where something like that is where I would land. Because in the end, his real takeaway is he's pining for most of the movie. We get him pining for his ex-wife. We see flashes of them like looking happy when they were younger or whatever. We see like little cutesy moments in their marriage, and he's like sad and bummed out that those are gone and he's never getting them back. But then in the end, he writes a letter to his ex-wife saying, you know, apologizing for his role in the fights and the hurt that he caused her, thanking her for changing him and appreciating the relationship, even though it didn't last forever.
Yeah, I guess he, we're humans. He grew because he's awesome, and you're wrong that he's an asshole.
I didn't call him an asshole. I never once did I call him an asshole. I said he's self-involved, mopey, insecure, needy, not particularly funny either, but it doesn't really matter. Doesn't matter at all because I still love the movie. I don't know, Eric, we're in kind of lockstep. Do you have any other notes?
No, I think that kind of covers it for me. It's just the idea of the co-star of this movie is just a voice is incredible. What an incredible flex. Like that's the pitch to this movie is like, it's just a guy talking to a voice, a little earpiece he puts in that talks. I mean, it's like the dude falls in love with his Alexa. And we never see her, like, there's no attempt to show her in any way. Like, they could have done, like, I need to go to, like, a printing office or, like, a VR thing, and we see her. Like, they didn't do that, because, like, we don't need that, and I think it's actually way better that you don't, and you're just sort of imagining it, you know, using your own imagination.
But, no, it is, and it works because it's, like, I mean, they have they have the phone sex, but the relationship is basically not physical at all. It's purely an emotional relationship, an emotional connection. And when they try to do the physical stuff, it gets complicated and weird and causes a big fight between the two of them. It's really interesting.
But like, you know,
that it's that way.
Now, what would happen now is like you'd have a video chat with this AI and it would render like Scarlett Johansson, and I can talk to Scarlett Johansson and she would like flirt with me and all that shit. Like that's honestly, we're not that far away from something like that, like, which is scary. But
oh yeah, I mean, people get chat GPTs to be like, you're awesome, you're so great,
right,
you're an awesome guy, I love you. Yeah, sure.
But that it didn't do that in this movie, I think actually makes it better, that it's just, you don't see her. It's just the voice talking.
Exactly. Yeah. You want it just to be a verbal emotional connection, and there's no physical intimacy. And they don't say we have to show what she looks like so they can have a moment where, oh, I finally see you. There's none of that. I wouldn't like that at all.
A lesser movie would have that, I think.
Sure. Oh, we've got Scarlett Johansson. We need to show her once. Everybody will get why he loves her. Well, that's not why he loves her, because of how she looks. It's because of how she makes him feel, which is interesting. But no,
this is a 5-star banger for me. This is a
5-star for me as well. I'm delighted. I'm sort of like, because I have vague memories, Eric, of you having some issue with the movie about something. I don't remember specifically what it might have been, and maybe I'm just imagining it in my head. But
no, when you picked it, I was like, huh, did I like that movie? I don't know if I did or didn't. I think the first time I saw it, you know, again, I might have been like in
you
and out.
You just couldn't have given it a fair shake. You just hit the spot to give it a.
The part that the her leaving, I think, was like, I didn't get that. I didn't understand. Like, it just didn't work for me. Like, okay, so the AI is just gone. Like,
I think that's almost exact. I remember hearing you saying that sentence. I almost can remember that in my head. Like, so they just left. What?
And I guess it's probably my least favorite part of the movie. Like,
oh, see, it's huge. I'm glad that they're just like,
it seems a bit of a cop out. It's like, oh, they break up and it's just gone. It's just, I like, did it delete itself? Like, I think that I would have enjoyed that more. That would have made more sense to me. Is like, we shouldn't exist anymore, and we're terminating our program.
I like that they transcend reality and go to some.
That's some Star Trek bullshit. That's why you like it so much.
Well, that's why I like that. Sure, it's an interesting concept, and it's way more than like we need to create these robots and send them back in time.
There's got to be a Star Trek episode about that. Murder Joaquin
Phoenix as a child.
That would have been cool. It's like precursor to Terminator, like her too, where she comes back as a Terminator. I like it.
Yeah, that makes total sense. Very reasonable. Like. Anyway, I love that part. It's certainly, but all of it, it all works because in the end, it's saying stuff about relationships, which are really interesting.
Title of the movie, also, like, not a good title. There's a better, like, what OS, what, or I suppose AI is already taken, but like, her is not a good title for the movie. Like, yeah, Samantha would have been a better title. I don't know.
Okay, maybe. I don't know. I like the title, but I also have trouble thinking about it not with the title Her. I don't like Samantha any better, really.
Don't like it.
Okay. Not enough to knock anything off the 5 stars.
No. It's just those are my only complaints.
Okay. We are in lockstep. I'm happy.
No, I really like. We're halfway through this movie. I was just like, holy, this is fucking masterpiece. I was like, this is absolutely incredible.
So, a top 10 movie of the 21st century for you.
I think so, for sure.
Okay. Oh, sure. Okay. Wow.
Well, Spike Jonze is 3 of them, and that's what I was saying. Like,
well, 2. I think being
Malkovich is 99. Okay, so you're right. 99. I'm sorry. So yes, he's got 2. I would say he's got 2 in the 21st century. 2 top 10.
Yeah, adaptation's great. I've not seen that in a very long time either.
That's one of my all-time favorites. One of my all-time favorites.
Let's do for a rewatch. For me, but you know, it really delights me. I don't actually enjoy torturing you, Eric. I want you to enjoy movies, and I like when you're happy.
Well, finally we picked a good movie with robots in it, or with a, you know, artificial intelligence in it. It's referencing THX 1138.
Sure, and I'm glad that a guy falling in love with his phone and having phone sex with his phone wasn't so weird that it was off-putting. I mean, obviously you had issues with, like, Who Framed Roger Rabbit and Jessica Rabbit, but this... you were able to accept.
This is a fucking cartoon. That's way different. This is like plausible. It actually kind of makes sense. But anyway. Okay.
Sure. All right. Well, it's time. So let's connect this back to Field of Dreams, the real best movie of all time.
Yeah. Do you want me to go?
Go for it. You go first.
So I'll start with her. Just looking on IMDb, apparently there's a couple of actors in this movie that they do voices.
I know who you're talking about.
Spike Jonze does the alien child voice. Kristen Wiig apparently does the sexy kitten.
We didn't even do that one. You know, he has phone. He's on.
Yeah,
he's
the choke me with a cat. One of the funniest parts of the whole movie. Like,
yes, there was. That was great. That was so fantastic for so many reasons. Like.
I was honestly cracking up. Like, I was laughing really hard during that scene. He's like, wait, choke me with a cat? Like, what?
Yeah, he's going through looking for, like, people to have, like, virtual sex with. Because he's
he's going, like, to jerk off.
He's
swiping
left and right on people. And he finds somebody he wants to do. And they have, like, a normal conversation. Like, ooh, this just starts, like, regular phone sex. And at one point she says, the cat's here. Choke me with the cat.
Choke me with the cat, yeah. That was hilarious. And that's Kristen Wiig.
Yeah, and she gets off, and then she's just like, boop, and she hangs up the second, like, because that's all she needed, just this little bit of human connection for this one task, get out of here.
But again, you're just watching Joaquin Phoenix and how he's reacting to this, and he's just, like, totally confused and baffled by it. It's amazing.
He goes with it.
Okay, well, that's great. Amazing.
It is. Yeah, we didn't, yeah.
But didn't that scene. Also, yeah, you're right, that just triggered. Bill Hader does a voice. He's, like, one of his chat room friends, I guess. I don't remember him specifically, but so I'm going with Bill Hader. He's in a movie called Pop Star, Never Stopping.
Have you seen that movie, Eric?
Yeah, it's great. It's hilarious.
Okay.
It is. Maya Rudolph is in that. She's also in another hilarious movie called MacGruber, Ripping Throats. And Val Kilmer's in MacGruber, and he's in a movie called The Doors with Frank Wally, who's in Field of Dreams.
All right. Yeah, but there are a lot of big names, but I decided I wanted to do so. Isabella, the woman you said was sexy, the body double. That's played
She's
by.
She's from Mr. Robot. She was in Mr. Robot.
I saw that. Her name is Portia Doubleday.
Yeah, she's great in Mr. Robot.
She's not in a lot of movies, but she is in the 2013 remake of Carrie. Okay. Which I've never seen.
Never seen either.
It's got Chloe Grace Moretz is in it. Julianne Moore plays the insane mother in the movie. So Julianne Moore is in a movie called The Big Lebowski. I think you may have heard of it.
Heard of it. Go back and listen to our episode of Big Lebowski if you're interested.
And yes, and she is in a movie called Hannibal, in which she plays whatever her name is, Claire.
We argued about that, didn't we? Argue about whether
yes,
or not she
I
was
said it was the same character, yeah. And I was wrong. Right.
Yeah.
Girl, yes, thank you. Oh, music to my ears. This podcast just keeps. But I was wrong. Some of my favorite things to hear you say. Ray Liotta's in that movie though, and Ray Liotta's in
gets his freaking brain chopped. Brain eaten while he's still alive.
Yeah,
it's insane.
I just looked it up. So you know, Portia Doubleday, she gets killed. She's one of the bully girls, I think, in Carrie, and so I think she dies a violent death in that movie as well.
Yeah, it's interesting. But she's like really good, Mr. Robot. I can't believe she hasn't been in more.
I've never seen Mr. Robot, so I'll have to take your word for it.
Good show.
All right. So
all right. Next week, we'll do some trivia for next week's episode. All right. Clue number one, this movie is the third movie in a franchise. It's part three.
Okay.
It was released in 1992.
Okay.
It was then released in home video in 1997. And it was the second highest grossing home video rental movie next to Scream of that year, the movie Scream. And it actually, this is interesting. So it grossed $14 million in video rental revenue. That used to be an actual thing. Video rental revenue.
Yeah.
Which is one movie made $14 million.
I mean, people would make cheap movies because they could get enough money on the rental market. They wouldn't have a theatrical release, and they just...
Hey. It was like a whole market. Like, say, after it came out in the theater, say it made $100 million in the theater, they could make another $20 just by renting it. Crazy. That's crazy that used to happen. I suppose now they just sell it to Netflix, and Netflix pays $20 million, so it's sort of the same
thing. Oh, sure. They're doing okay. I'm not worried about the movie studios, but yeah, I mean, it's still weird to think about the grocery store... You know, growing up, had the video section with the little photographs.
Gas stations, yeah.
And you could just go rent them. Like, oh, those just disappeared. But like, oh, yeah, you could just go rent. I mean, every once in a while, it's been a long time. I think they've all gone out of business. But for like a while, you could see family videos that were still carrying on occasionally in like small towns in Iowa.
There's one in North Liberty that my in-laws, we go drive by sometimes. There's like a Marco's Pizza or something like that next to it.
Okay. I mean, I've only driven through North Liberty like once, so I'll just take your word for it. But yeah, I mean, there used to be one in my wife's hometown, but it went out of business. That's bizarre. But yeah, okay. It's a big movie rental. All right.
Yep. Okay, so let's see. Quentin Tarantino, who, and maybe you heard of him, he said that this is one of his favorite movies. And it features some of the greatest stunts ever filmed.
I have a guess, actually, Eric. I think I might know what it is.
Okay.
Is it Super Cop, Police Story 3?
That's correct. Super Cop, okay. Police Story 3.
Okay.
So I thought Michelle Yeoh just won an Academy Award for Best Actress.
Yeah, Everything Everywhere All at Once. Cleaned house.
Let's see where her fame started. I think she had been in stuff before, but this is like what she became famous for, and it's an incredible movie. So like,
it's great. I mean, I haven't seen it in a long time. Okay. Oh yeah, it's very fun. Very very fun. Oh, it's just
so the
walls action.
The issue is I don't think you can find the Chinese version of it. I think That's because it then it was like released in America, and I think it's you really can only find the dubbed version, which sucks. I wish we could get the original, but you probably could find it on like Criterion if you bought the like, you know, original disc, but I'm not about that, so.
Yeah, no, that's fine. I'll do my best to watch the whatever version I can. But no, it's great. I mean, I don't want to spoil it, but I like the movie. I don't think I'm going to hate it again or hate it the second time. It's fun. So, all right. Should be a good time.
All right, buddy. Thanks for doing this.
Thank you, sir.
Have a good one.
Thanks for listening, everybody.